Hello, and welcome to our 2020 review. 2020 was a terrible year for everyone around the globe. But astronomers and telescopes, ground-based, satellite, they continued to operate. And they came up with a number of interesting observations and discoveries that we'll cover in this video. We have news on the rings around Saturn. We'll take a look at some of the storms going on Jupiter. We'll see a new comet, an interesting comet that has two tails. We'll cover Fomalhaut B, an exoplanet that disappeared. Betelgeuse has dimmed quite a bit, and that has implications, possibly. You may recall a video where we saw as the shadow of a nebula. It was re-examined in 2020, and it's moved slightly. It's called the bat shadow. So we'll take another look at that. And we'll fly through the Orion Nebula, looking at it in visible light and infrared. A little further out, we'll take a look at a Wolf-Rayet star, a fading planetary nebula, and the stars in the Milky Way bulge, trying to figure out how old they might be. We'll also see some spectacular nebula in and around the Large Magellanic Cloud, some distant galaxies, a fading supernova, and a very early galaxy as seen through gravitational lensing. We'll end with a deeper dive into the James Webb Space Telescope, the new telescope designed for the infrared and near-infrared that should launch here in 2021. And we'll cover a few of the things that it will look at, like galactic dust and the first stars that ever formed into the first galaxies. I trust you'll find it informative and entertaining. We'll start with Saturn's rings. The Hubble Space Telescope took this picture of Saturn on July 4th, 2020, when the planet was just 1,350 million kilometers from Earth. That's 839 million miles. At that time, it was summer in the planet's northern hemisphere. The rings are mostly made of pieces of ice, with sizes ranging from tiny grains to giant boulders. Just how and when the rings formed remains one of our solar system's biggest mysteries. Conventional wisdom is that they are as old as the planet itself, around 4 billion years. We covered this in the How Old Is It video book. But a competing theory is that they may have formed more recently, during the past few hundred million years. The Cassini spacecraft measurements of tiny grains raining down from the rings into Saturn's atmosphere suggest the rings can only last for around 300 million more years. This is one of the arguments for a young age for the ring system. The Hubble Space Telescope and the ground-based Gemini Observatory in Hawaii have teamed up with the Juno spacecraft to probe Jupiter's storms. Every 53 days, Juno moves low over the storm systems, detecting high-frequency radio waves, which can then be used to map lightning, even on the day side of the planet or from deep inside clouds, where flashes are not otherwise visible. Coinciding with each pass, Hubble's visible light images and Gemini's thermal infrared images tell us how thick the clouds are and how deep we are seeing into them. This is an illustration of lightning, convection towers, deep water clouds, and clearings in Jupiter's atmosphere. The region illustrated covers a horizontal span one-third greater than that of the continental United States. This ground-based C2020 F3 Neowise comet photo was taken on July 16, 2020, just 13 days after the comet's closest approach to the Sun, at a distance of 43 million kilometers, or 27 million miles. Neowise stands for the Near-Earth Object Wide Field Infrared Survey Explorer mission that discovered the comet. It is the brightest comet visible from the Northern Hemisphere since 1997's Hale-Bopp. Note the separate blue tail veering off the top. Normal tails are pushed by sunlight. The blue tail contains ions, charged particles, that are pushed by the charged particles in the solar wind. It's headed to the outer solar system, currently traveling at 232,000 kilometers per hour. That's 144,000 miles per hour. It will not return to the Sun for another 7,000 years. The inset image was taken by the Hubble telescope on August 8th. Other comets often break apart due to thermal gravitational stresses at such close encounters with the Sun. But Neowise's solid nucleus stayed intact. Hubble's image zeroes in on the comet's nucleus, which is too small to be seen. It's estimated to measure no more than 4.8 kilometers or 3 miles across. Instead, the image shows a portion of the comet's coma, which measures about 18,000 kilometers or 11,000 miles across. In our segment on nearby stars, we covered the protoplanet Fomalhaut b around the star Fomalhaut. Turns out that that planet has disappeared. Astronomers are looking for a plausible explanation. One interpretation is that rather than being a full-size planetary object, which was first photographed in 2004, it could instead be a vast, expanding cloud of dust produced in a collision between two large bodies orbiting the star. If confirmed, this will become a blueprint for how planets destroy each other. Others analyzed all available archive Hubble data on Fomalhaut b and concluded that the planet-sized object never existed in the first place. This diagram simulates an expanding and fading cloud instead of a planet. We should know more when the new James Webb Space Telescope is available for deeper infrared examination of the Fomalhaut disk. Here's Betelgeuse in early 2019. Normally, the star expands and contracts, brightening and dimming on a 420-day cycle. However, in October 2019, the star dimmed dramatically. Hubble captured signs of dense, heated material moving through the star's atmosphere in September, October, and November 2019. Then in December, several ground-based telescopes observed the star decreasing in brightness in its southern hemisphere. By mid-February 2020, the star had lost more than two-thirds of its luminosity. The ultraviolet observations by Hubble suggest that the unexpected dimming was probably caused by an immense amount of super-hot material ejected into space. The material cooled and formed a dust cloud, and blocked the sunlight coming from about a quarter of Betelgeuse's surface, as seen from our line of sight. By April 2020, the star returned to normal brightness. The giant star is destined to end its life in a supernova blast. Some astronomers think the sudden dimming may be a pre-supernova event. In our 2018 review, we covered the shadow cast by a debris ring around the star HBC 672 in the Serpens Nebula, 1,300 light-years away. Its nickname was the Bat Shadow. A recent relook at the object showed that the shadow had unexpectedly moved slightly. Astronomers think that the disk of circling gas, dust, and rock might be roughly saddle-shaped, with an embedded planet with an orbit inclined to the disk's plane. They estimate that this planet would be about the same distance from its star as the Earth is from the Sun. This planet would be the cause of the doubly warped shape of the orbiting disk and the resulting movement in its shadow. Here we are zooming into the planetary nebula NGC 7027. The nebula is about 1 light-year across. In 2020, its central star was viewed by Hubble in near-ultraviolet light. Hubble first looked at this planetary nebula in 1998 using visible and infrared light. By comparing the old and new Hubble observations, researchers have additional opportunities to study the object as it changes over time. These observations will help reveal how much dust obscures the star and how hot the star really is. This visualization explores the Orion Nebula using both visible and infrared light. The sequence begins with a wide field view of the sky showing the plane of our Milky Way galaxy, then zooms down into the scale of the Orion Nebula. The visible light observations from the Hubble Space Telescope and the infrared light observations from the Spitzer Space Telescope are compared first in two-dimensional images and then in three-dimensional models. As the camera flies into the star-forming region, the sequence crossfades back and forth between the visible and infrared views. This color composite mosaic of the central part of the Orion Nebula is based on 81 images from the European Southern Observatory Very Large Telescope in Chile. The famous trapezium star appears near the center, amid the trapezium cluster, the very crowded home of more than 1,000 young stars. Researchers will train the James Webb Space Telescope on this region to study phenomena associated with the formation of stars and planets. Here we are zooming into the star cluster Westerland 2 in the GUM 29 H2 star forming region, 14,000 light years away. It's only 2 million years old and contains some of the most massive, hottest young stars in the Milky Way. The Hubble Space Telescope was used to conduct a 3-year study of this cluster from 2016 to 2019. This study sought to investigate the properties of stars during their early evolutionary phases and to trace the evolution of their circumstellar disk environments. They found that the most massive and brightest stars in the cluster are found in the core. Westerland 2 contains at least 37 extremely massive stars, some with up to 100 solar masses. These stars do not have planet-forming circumstellar disks around them, and the study found that the stars near these giants also exist without circumstellar disks. Further from the center, they found that most of the stars do indeed have these dust cloud disks. One explanation for this situation is that the blistering ultraviolet radiation and strong stellar winds from the central stars erode the disks around neighboring stars, dispersing the giant dust clouds that one day may have formed planets. This cluster will be an excellent target for follow-up observations with the upcoming James Webb Space Telescope. Here we see the pairing of the Wolf-Rayet star WR124 and the nebula M167, which surrounds it. Both objects, captured here by Hubble, lie 15,000 light years away. The star shines brightly at the very center of this explosive image and around the hot clumps of gas that are ejected into space at over 150,000 kilometers per hour. That's 93,000 miles per hour. The nebula is estimated to be no more than 10,000 years old, which is quite young in astronomical terms. A version of this image was released in 1998, but has now been re-reduced with the latest software. Wolf-Rayet stars are a rare set of very hot stars with spectra that indicate a very high surface content of heavy elements, little or no hydrogen, and strong stellar winds. Their surface temperatures range from 30,000 to 210,000 degrees Kelvin. That's hotter than almost all other stars. These stars are older, massive stars that have completely lost their outer hydrogen and are fusing helium, or heavier elements, in the core. Here we are zooming into HEN 1357, known as the Stingray Nebula. Even though the universe is constantly changing, most processes are too slow to be observed within a human lifespan. However, this nebula is now providing scientists a unique opportunity to observe a system's evolution in real time. Stingray is the youngest known planetary nebula, having formed around the collapsing central supergiant star, HE3-1357, starting in 1987. By 1995, the central star was a white dwarf. Images captured by Hubble in 2016, when compared to Hubble images taken in 1996, show a nebula that has drastically dimmed in brightness and changed shape. Bright blue shells of gas near the center of the nebula have all but disappeared, and the wavy edges that earned this nebula its aquatic-themed name are virtually gone. The young nebula no longer shines as brightly against the black background of the distant universe. The oxygen gas emission, in particular, has dropped in brightness by a factor of nearly 1,000. This image captures a 220 by 110 light years portion of our galaxy's bulge. It contains over 180,000 stars. A survey team is analyzing these stars to see how old they are. The question at hand is, did the stars within the bulge form early in our galaxy's history, 10 to 12 billion years ago, or did they build up over time through multiple episodes of star formation? Some studies have found evidence for at least two star-forming bursts, leading to stellar populations as old as 10 billion years or as young as 3 billion years. Now, a comprehensive new study of millions of stars found that most stars within 1,000 light years of the Milky Way's center formed 10 billion years ago. But the study is not conclusive. The James Webb Space Telescope will be used to help find the answers to this question. Here we are zooming into LHA-120N150, a star-forming region near the outskirts of the famous Tarantula Nebula in the Large Magellanic Cloud. This cloud of gas and dust, as well as the many young and massive stars surrounding it, is an excellent laboratory for studying the origins of massive stars. Theoretical models for the formation of massive stars suggest that they form within clusters of stars. But observations indicate that up to 10% of them formed in isolation. With the help of Hubble, astronomers are trying to find out whether the isolated stars visible in the nebula truly formed alone or just moved away from their original stellar grouping. However, such a study is not an easy task. Young stars, before they fully form, especially massive ones, look very similar to dense clumps of dust. This star-forming region contains several dozens of these objects. They are a mix of unclassified sources, some probably young stellar objects, and others probably dust clumps. Only detailed analysis and observations will reveal the true nature, and that will help to finally solve the unanswered question of the origin of massive stars. Many colorful stars are packed close together in this image of the globular cluster NGC 1805, taken by Hubble. This tight grouping of thousands of stars is located near the edge of the Large Magellanic Cloud. In the dense center, stars are 100 to 1,000 times closer together than the nearest stars are to our Sun. This makes planetary system formation around them highly unlikely. The striking difference in star color is illustrated beautifully in this image, which combines two different types of starlight. Blue stars, shining brightest in near ultraviolet light, and red stars, illuminated in red and near infrared. Usually, globular clusters contain stars which are born at the same time. However, NGC 1805 is unusual as it appears to host two different populations of stars, with ages of the older red stars being millions of years older than the blue young stars. Here's an interesting pair of nebula in the Large Magellanic Cloud named the Cosmic Reef. They show how young, energetic, massive stars illuminate and sculpt their vicinity with powerful winds and searing ultraviolet radiation. The blue nebula at lower left, NGC 2020, has been created by a solitary mammoth star 200,000 times brighter than our Sun. The blue gas was ejected by the star through a series of eruptive events during which it lost part of its outer envelope of material. The giant red nebula, 2014, on the upper right, has at its center a grouping of bright stars, each 10 to 20 times more massive than our Sun. The star's ultraviolet radiation heats the surrounding dense gas and unleash fierce winds of charged particles that blast away lower density gas, forming the bubble-like structure seen on the right. The star's powerful stellar winds are pushing gas and dust to the denser left side of the nebula, where it is piling up, creating a series of dark ridges bathed in sunlight. The blue and orange stars in this faint galaxy, NGC 2188, sparkle in this image. Although the galaxy appears at first glance to consist solely of a narrow band of stars, it is classified by astronomers as a barred spiral galaxy. It appears this way from our viewpoint on Earth, as the center of the spiral arms of the galaxy are tilted away from us, making only the very narrow outer edge of the galaxy visible. The true shape of the galaxy was identified by studying the distribution of the stars in the inner central bulge and outer disk, and by observing the stars' colors. The many stars and dust and gas clouds that make up NGC 5585, shown here in this Hubble image, contribute only a small fraction of the total mass of the galaxy. As in many galaxies, this discrepancy can be explained by the presence of dark matter. The stellar disk of the galaxy extends over 35,000 light years across. When compared with galaxies of similar shape and size, 5585 stands out by having a noticeably higher proportion of dark matter. The twisting patterns created by the multiple spiral arms of NGC 2835 create the illusion of an eye. The stunning barred spiral galaxy, with a width just over half that of the Milky Way, is brilliantly featured in this Hubble image. Although it cannot be seen in this image, a supermassive black hole with a mass millions of times that of our Sun is known to exist in the center of the galaxy. This galaxy was imaged as part of a large galaxy survey that's studying the connections between cold gas and young stars in a variety of galaxies in the local universe. Within 2835, this cold, dense gas produces large numbers of young stars within large star formation regions. The bright blue areas show where new ultraviolet light is being emitted more strongly, indicating recent or ongoing star formation. Here's supernova 2018 GV, the Type 1a supernova in the spiral galaxy NGC 2525, 70 million light years away. Hubble began observing it in February 2018, after the supernova was first detected by amateur astronomer Koichi Itagaki a few weeks earlier in mid-January. This was one of the supernovae used as part of the program to precisely measure the expansion rate of the universe that we covered in the How Far Away Is It segment on the cosmos. In the time-lapse sequence spanning nearly a year, the supernova first appeared as a blazing star located on the galaxy's outer edge. It initially outshines the brightest stars in the galaxy before fading out of sight. This Hubble Space Telescope photograph showcases the majestic spiral galaxy UGC 2885, located 232 million light-years away. The galaxy is 2.5 times wider than our Milky Way and contains 10 times as many stars. A number of foreground stars in our Milky Way can be seen in the image, identified by their diffraction spikes. The brightest one is on the line of sight to the galaxy's disk. The galaxy has been nicknamed Rubin's Galaxy after astronomer Vera Rubin, who studied the galaxy's rotation rate in search of dark matter. The James Webb Space Telescope could be used to explore the center of this galaxy, as well as the globular cluster population around it. In the How Old Is It video book segment on the Lambda Cold Dark Matter Big Bang Benchmark Model, we covered the dark ages between the release of the cosmic background radiation photons and the first light from stars formed from hydrogen, helium, and lithium, the only elements available in the universe at that time. These are called Population 3 stars. The earliest expected time for these stars is 150 million years after the Big Bang. Using gravitational lensing, created by the galaxy cluster MAX-J0416 and its surroundings, a team of astronomers using the Hubble Space Telescope were able to see galaxies 10 to 100 times fainter than any previously observed, with ages as far back as 500 million years after the Big Bang. They found no evidence of these first-generation Population 3 stars. The Big Bang theory has it that there should be plenty of them. This creates a mystery that might be resolved by the new James Webb Space Telescope. In this 2020 review, we've pointed to a few areas of astronomical research that need a better look with a telescope larger than Hubble. These include exoplanet formation exploration, like finding out what happened to Fomalhaut B, star and planet formation in places like the Trapezian Cluster in the Orion Nebula, the age of stars in the Milky Way Central Bulge, and the search for first-generation Population 3 stars, just to name a few. That telescope is the James Webb Space Telescope. It is almost 3 times the size of Hubble. It has been in development for over a decade and is scheduled for launch in 2021. It's optimized for observations in the near-infrared. We'll cover its key components and where it will orbit. We'll finish with a deeper look at 2 areas of investigation that Webb will probe: galactic dust and the makeup of the early universe. Here are Webb's primary and secondary mirrors. The primary is the size of a tennis court. This animation shows the light path through the telescope. The light reflects off the primary and is focused onto the secondary, where it is beamed into the camera. Webb's mirrors are covered in a microscopically thin layer of gold, which optimizes them for reflecting infrared light. Other key components include the cameras, the sun shield, the solar panels, communications antenna, the computer, and spacecraft control. The sun shield is particularly important because of the telescope's extreme sensitivity to heat. Webb primarily observes infrared light, which can sometimes be felt as heat. Because the telescope will be observing the very faint infrared signals of very distant objects, it needs to be shielded from any bright, hot sources. This also includes the telescope's own electronics equipment. It operates at 233 degrees below zero Celsius. That's minus 388 degrees Fahrenheit. That's cold enough to freeze nitrogen. The shield can protect against temperatures on its hot side as high as 85 degrees Celsius. That's 185 degrees Fahrenheit, a little under the boiling point for water. If either the sun, Earth, or the moon are on the cold side, the telescope won't work. So to have the sun shield be effective protection against the light and heat of the sun, Earth, and moon, these bodies have to all be located in the same direction. This is why the telescope must orbit at the L2 Lagrange point, 1.5 million kilometers from Earth. That's 1 million miles. You'll recall from our coverage of Lagrange points in our How Far Away Is It segment on the solar system that objects can, with a little assist, orbit L2. This animation shows how this will work. To remain in orbit around L2, Webb will have to periodically burn small amounts of fuel. This puts a time limit on the usefulness of the telescope at around 10 years. Dust is a key ingredient in interstellar space because cosmic dust shelters forming stars, becomes part of planets, and can contain the organic compounds that lead to life as we know it. One of astronomy's mysteries is, where did galactic dust come from? To find out, Webb will be studying dust-producing Wolf-Rayet binary stars like this one, WR140, 5,300 light-years away. There is evidence that these stars, through interactions with a companion star, produce large amounts of dust in a distinctive pinwheel pattern as the two stars orbit each other and their stellar winds collide, as shown in this image. This animation shows the production of dust in the binary star system WR140 as the orbit of the Wolf-Rayet star approaches the O-type star and their stellar winds collide. The stronger winds of the Wolf-Rayet star blow back behind the O star, and dust is created in its wake as the mixed stellar material cools. As the process repeats over and over, the dust will form a distinctive pinwheel shape. It is possible that these binary star systems account for a large percentage of a galaxy's dust. However, the intense luminosity and heat coming from the Wolf-Rayet stars has made it difficult to study the faint, more diffuse dust in these systems. This is where Webb comes in. The mid-infrared light that Webb can detect is exactly the wavelength of light we need to study the dust and its chemical composition. Our ability to see into the earliest galaxies is limited by how far the Hubble Space Telescope can reach. This is because the light is so dim, and the wavelength of that light has been stretched into the infrared due to the expansion of the universe. The James Webb Space Telescope is larger for collecting more light and built for the infrared part of the electromagnetic spectrum. Early quasars provide a good example of what we can expect. Quasars are the brightest objects in the universe They outshine entire galaxies of billions of stars. A supermassive black hole lies at the heart of every quasar, but not every black hole is a quasar. Only the black holes that are acquiring massive amounts of new material can power a quasar. Although quasars are known to reside at the centers of galaxies, it's been difficult to tell what those galaxies are like and how they compare to galaxies without quasars. The challenge is that the quasar's glare makes it difficult or impossible to tease out the light of the surrounding host galaxy. It's like looking directly into a car headlight and trying to figure out what kind of automobile it is attached to. The James Webb Space Telescope will be able to reveal the host galaxies of distant quasars despite their small sizes and obscuring dust. To determine what Webb is expected to see, a team of astronomers used a state-of-the-art computer simulation called Blue Tides. It's designed to study the formation and evolution of galaxies and quasars in the first billion years of the universe's history. Its large cosmic volume and high spatial resolution enables it to study those rare quasar hosts on a statistical basis. It's providing good agreement with current observations and allows astronomers to predict what Webb will see. This video zooms into a highly detailed simulation of the universe. It starts out spanning about 200 million light years and ends up spanning only 200,000 light years, focused on two galaxies. One final note, Webb's ability to see into circumstellar disks, where planets form, should provide enough material for an entire video book chapter on exoplanets. Hopefully we'll know by this time next year. Here are the links to Hubble sites, white papers, and other locations where I found the information contained in this 2020 review. These are also the places where you can go to begin your own research. Also, thanks to Jonathan Onsted, there is a How Far Away Is It Wiki available for anyone who wants to engage in conversations about this or any channel video. I want to call your attention to a new free online textbook called Astronomy that anyone interested in astronomy can use. It is supported by the OpenStax, a Rice University 501c3 nonprofit charity. The book builds student understanding through the use of relevant analogies, clear and non-technical explanations, and rich illustrations. And don't forget, every video has a document on the howfarawayisit.com website containing all the text. Download and translate as needed. Thanks for watching.